evening.
Good evening.
I greet you in the name of the Lord. This is Kingdom Concepts 3. Subtitle is Eschatology. And this is week number 6. We're way behind our original syllabus. We're trying to catch up, and we're going to eventually get there, I suppose. But I think that what's really going to be important is that we have as clear understanding as we possibly can of what we're presenting, even if that means that we don't even complete everything that we had intended. I would rather, I guess, that you have a good understanding than to try to just rush over everything and leave you hanging or in the dark, so to speak. Now, I had intended to take a look, a final look at last week's lesson, and I'm thinking that I'm going to skip over that. What I was going to give you was, well, I'll go ahead and tell you what the four keys are of interpreting the apocalypse. And keep in mind, when we talk about the apocalypse, the word apocalypse means hidden, or what is revealed. That which is hidden is revealed. And when we speak about the book of Revelation as being the apocalypse or an apocalypse, we're talking about the unveiling of something that maybe has been hidden. Okay? Hollywood has portrayed apocalypse or apocalyptic event as being destruction, explosion, everything going up in flames. And I think even Christian leaders have portrayed it as being planes crashing and drivers being raptured out and everybody colliding on the interstates. But the true understanding of the book of Revelation and the apocalypse is to understand that it is the unveiling or the revealing of Jesus Christ. Okay? And so I'm going to give you four keys, and I would love to develop this more, but I think that we really need to move on. And the four keys are, I'll pull this up, and the first key of understanding the apocalypse, and the reason why that I believe this is important for us to talk about the apocalypse here is that the same principles, the same rules that we would use to unlock the mysteries of the apocalypse are really the same principle that we would interpret any prophetic scripture. Okay? And since we're talking about eschatology or the study of last things, we have to consider the book of Revelation. We have to have an understanding of the book of Revelation because that's where most people's eschatology comes from. But keep in mind, eschatology is really a school of thought. Eschatology, as we're going to see in a few moments, is not only future, but eschatology can even be a part of our past and our present as well as our future. So the revelation uses figurative language and symbols to reveal spiritual and spiritual slash physical realities. And without going through all of this, let me just say this, and this is good. Imagery is the means by which, well, let me go ahead and give these to you, and I will go through these quickly. The first is, Revelation uses figurative language. The revelation is timeless, meaning it's not just relegated to some futuristic date. I believe that the book of Revelation is an unveiling of Christ and His church.
Yes, sir.
It's the unveiling of the present day ongoing kingdom of God. The third principle, or the third key to interpreting the apocalypse, and let the Bible interpret itself. And just like when Jesus, well, it, even in the book of Revelation, when it talks about the seven candlesticks and the seven stars, John goes ahead and tells you what those are, right?
Yep.
So let the scripture interpret itself. And judge any interpretation by the fruit it produces. And I will say this, that's a traditional teaching of the pre-tribulational dispensational rapture has produced the fruit of fear. Okay?
Absolutely.
Now, we'll go through these very quickly. Just write this down. You go ahead and write those four keys down. But don't try to write down everything that I'm going to be showing because we'll go through them very quickly here, okay? Now, this is good. You may want to write this down. Imagery is the means by which the infinite God communicates with finite humans about spiritual truths. Imagery is the means by which the infinite God communicates with finite humans about spiritual truths. Why bother about spirit realm realities? Don't write this down. Well, first of all, God's a spirit, right? People talk about, you know, that you spiritualize or you try to understand the spiritual meaning of something. Well, God is a spirit. Guess what? We're human. We are spirit beings, right? Kingdom of God is a spirit realm kingdom. So those are the reasons why that we ought to be considered or why we should be concerned about spirit realm reality, because that's where the real reality is. And this is a good point here. Spirit realm reality can only be received spiritually. You can only understand spiritual truths spiritually. You cannot understand spiritual truths carnally. You cannot properly interpret spiritual truths with the unregenerated carnal mind. Cannot be understood intellectually. It must be understood spiritually. Now, when we say the revelation is timeless, basically what that is saying is that it's not relegated, the book of Revelation, not relegated to some particular age. Now, there's some who, the preterists say it's already fulfilled. The full preterists. Keep in mind, you may want to make a note of this. We talked about it all the way through the course. Preterism refers to, in particular, Matthew 24 being fulfilled in 70 AD. Full preterists believe that all prophecies, including the resurrection and the coming of the Lord, took place in 70 AD. But then you have your partial preterists who believe that most of Matthew 24 was fulfilled in 70 AD, especially the judgment upon Jerusalem and the destruction of the temple, which brought an end to the sacrifice system of the temple. But partial preterists believe that there is yet something future, namely the resurrection. Okay? Now, lest anyone that would be frustrated, confused, or downright mad when you seem to, quote, discredit what they believe to be the scriptural teaching of the pre-tribulational rapture, I'm going to show you by the grace of God before this course is over that what dispensationalists have based that theory upon is not solid theology. And lest you would think that you're having anything stripped from you, remember this, that anything that you believe is associated with, quote, the rapture, in essence, will take place at the second coming, okay? We're not doing away with the second coming. We're not doing away with the consummation of the age. We're not doing away with the resurrection. We're not doing away with the translation of living saints. See, we're not doing away with those things. It's a matter of the teaching of the dispensationalists who make a distinction between Israel and the church, and they say that the church has to be out of here before God can deal with the Israelites, and God's going to revert back to the old sacrificial system, that is unbiblical. And it is not, in my opinion, it's not proper interpretation of Scripture that you can come up with this secret snatching away of the saints of God before a 7-year period of tribulation while God deals with Israel, and then Jesus comes. You can't find that in the Scripture.
No.
And you cannot properly interpret the 70th week of Daniel as dispensationalists do. So that's the reason why that we're basically taking a point of view in this class, even though that we're talking about premillennialism, we're talking about postmillennialism, and we're talking about amillennialism. We are also basically, I'm seeking to debunk a lot of false information that has been disseminated by dispensationalists, okay? So, you know, whatever your point of view is, after you have studied the Word of God, after you have searched out the Scripture, and you finish this course, if you still believe in that, that's your option, okay? And all I can say is that I believe that what we are doing here is seeking to properly divide, rightly divide, the Word of truth. And then it's left up to you to draw your own conclusion. Now, here's one of the things that some of you have had confusion over and has been to decide, well, am I this, am I that, am I something else? Well, I think there's some things we can say that we're not. But by the same token, there may be some truths. There are even some truths you can derive from dispensationalism. I'm not telling you everything that dispensationalists believe is wrong. I'm just telling you that the essence of what they believe is wrong, in my opinion, as I rightly divide the Word of truth, okay? But it'd be left up to you, between you and God and the Holy Spirit, to determine, you know, what you accept, what you don't accept. As a wise man said one time, that you learn to eat the chicken, spit out the bones. Or you learn to eat watermelon, spit out the seed, you know. But don't throw the baby away with the bathwater. Okay, so basically the revelation of time is just simply depicts Jesus as a present tense fulfillment of all prophecy. Present tense. So we can say, and again, the historic interpretation of Revelation just simply means that the events of Revelation have been fulfilled historically through the centuries. Okay. See, it was Jesus who's worthy to break the seals. It was Jesus who rides a white horse and defeats God's enemies. It was Jesus who shares a wedding supper with overcomers. Now, you know, we talk about the wedding supper, or we talk about the the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Marriage supper of the Lamb.
Now, let me just give you just a little clue here. If you are waiting to one day be married to the Lord Jesus Christ, you are presently living in an illicit relationship.
Yes, sir.
All right, that's good.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
That's good.
The truth is that we presently have a relationship. See, Paul says, I have espoused you to one husband.
Yep.
And he's speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you think that one day we're going to be married to Christ, remember this, that any reproduction that is taking place now is illicit.
That's good.
And
man,
we're not talking about, and see, when you talk about the marriage supper of the Lamb, you're talking about a relationship, you're talking about an intimacy, because Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will open the door, I will come in and have supper with you.
Right.
I will come in and sup with you. And that just simply means I will come in and we will have intimate fellowship. Mm-hmm. See? All right, it's Jesus who freely receives worship. So if you interpret the book of Revelation properly, you will see that it is really an ongoing revelation of Jesus Christ. And 30 times in the book of Revelation, Jesus is referred to as a lamb, which is a reference to Jesus as a Savior. And one thing that we know is that the book of Revelation is a revelation not of the earthly, natural Jesus, but of the glorified Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Let the Bible interpret itself. Sometimes it may be through direct statements, such as what must soon take place, not 2,000 years later, or the time is at hand, not 2,000 years later. Grace and peace to you from Him who is and who was and who is to come, referring to the present ruler of the kings of the earth. How many believe that Jesus right now is King of Kings?
Amen.
And Lord of Lords? Okay? And that's really, and He says, look, He is coming with clouds. Not just that He will one day come with clouds.
Mm-hmm. He is coming.
Yeah. Okay, and judge any interpretation by the fruit it produces. And again, I'm going through this very fast.
Mm-hmm.
And just keep in mind the four basic keys. Good fruit. Worshiping God. The 24 elders worshiping God before the throne. Good fruit. Godly character. And I will promise you that even all of the warfare or whatever is depicted in the book of Revelation is developing godly character. Good fruit, the expansion of God's kingdom. Worshiping God, developing godly character, and expanding His kingdom are the kinds of fruit God sought to produce by giving us the revelation, not the fruits of anxiety, fear, and dissension over the future. So just remember this. Judge any interpretation by the fruit it produces. Does it produce more love for Jesus? Does it produce worship of God? Does it produce love for your neighbor? Compassion for creation? Or does it produce fear and anxiety? Okay, now we're getting really to the essence of our lesson today, and that is to show that Jesus is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. Now, why is this important, and how does this tie in with eschatology? You see, we do have a lot of interchange and a lot of we have a lot of interlocking of the two courses that we're studying on Tuesday nights here, the book of Galatians, which is legalism versus grace, grace versus legalism,
yeah.
And how that Christ brought grace that was a fulfillment of the law, right? Now, why is it important for us to study in eschatology that Christ is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets? Is because, again, you have to determine whether that you take a futuristic view or if you take the view that the prophets and the law pointed to Christ. And if it points toward Christ, and if Christ is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets, then that would really wipe out any credibility that the dispensationalists have of saying, you know, that all of the Old Testament prophecy is yet to be fulfilled and that it's going to be fulfilled by the natural Jews. They don't recognize any of the prophets as speaking of the church, that the church is a plan B. The church is God's parentheses between His dealing with Israel before and His dealing with Israel at the end of the age or during the millennium. So what we're really establishing here is that rightly dividing the word of truth is that we show that the New Testament is a revealing of the Old Testament, and the Old Testament should be interpreted in light of the New Testament. Okay? And we don't interpret the New Testament in light of the Old Testament. You see the difference? We interpret the Old Testament by the light of the New Testament. The New Testament is our standard by which we measure and that we interpret Scripture. And as we say, eschatology is equally concerned with the past, the present, and the future, which means that eschatology, your eschatology, is going to be based on what has already happened, what is happening, and what will happen. which means that we must have a panoramic view of redemption. Now, why is it important for us to make that statement? See, a panoramic view of redemption simply means that we take into consideration the whole picture of redemption from Genesis all the way through Revelation. Now, how's this tie in with eschatology? Because, again, dispensationalists believe that God had a special plan of redemption for each of these dispensations. And they did not see the plan of redemption as being in the Old Testament and was a progression. So that's the reason why we have to take a panoramic view of redemption. The moment paradise was lost, or in other words, the very moment that Adam and Eve fell in the garden, God set in motion a plan for redemption. That's when it began. And it has been revealed from that point all the way to the final grace that was brought by the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, the first promise was Genesis 3:15. Basically, if you want to just make a note of that, just say that the seed of the woman is going to bruise the head of the seed of the serpent, and the seed of the serpent is going to bruise the heel. So that's really speaking about the enmity, and what it's speaking about here, the seed that's going to bruise the head of the serpent. Now, this is something that's also interesting to me. Now, Jesus did defeat Satan. How many of you believe Jesus bruised Satan's head? Mm-hmm. But think about this. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed.
Yeah.
Not only is there enmity that's placed between Jesus and the devil, and Jesus bruised the devil's head, but there is an enmity that's between his seed and Christ's seed.
Glory to God.
Okay? And what means that as Jesus bruised the head of the serpent, it's left up to us as the body of Christ to reckon to be so, and for us to put every enemy under our feet. See, Jesus already accomplished. Jesus will never do anything else because he's already done.
Amen.
That's what we mean by the finished work of Christ. There's nothing left to be done to fulfill a plan of redemption. It's already finished. Now, what we have to do is to walk out what Jesus has already done. And that's the reason why we say that the conflict was not only between the sea, but between, the enmity between thee and the woman. He's speaking to the serpent there, but it's going to be between thy seed and her seed. Again, Old Testament covenants were framed in terms of promise, the New Testament in terms of fulfillment. The Old Testament, just write down OT, promise, NT, fulfillment. I got fulfillment. Should be fulfillment. Okay. Of course, we know the law of Moses represented a covenant of works. The Redeemer must establish a covenant of grace so God would deliver Adam's fallen children. Now, again, this really is, in a sense, is a rehashing of the essence of the book of Galatians. But again, we're establishing the fact that the plan of God started with the fall of man and progressed all the way through the Old Testament. God has never had a plan B. God didn't say, well, you know, since Israel didn't fulfill their calling, I'm going to raise up the church. The church is a revelation. The church in the New Testament, or the church that's revealed in the New Testament, is a revelation of the church that was hidden in Old Testament scripture. Now, according to covenantal theology, the history of redemption is a progressive unfolding of a covenant of works and a covenant of grace throughout the whole of Scripture. And then again, this is contrary to the thinking of dispensationalists. Don't write all that down, because really covenantal theology is a particular line of thinking. Now, I have always thought in terms believing that it's either dispensationalism or covenantal theology. And I do believe in a covenantal theology, but covenantal theology really refers to the teaching, the basic teaching of Presbyterianism and of John Calvin. It's really a teaching of John Calvin, which I'm not saying it's right or wrong. In fact, I would probably agree with most anything that Calvin taught. There are five major points, and I don't remember exactly what all of them are, but one of the points being that, you know, their salvation was not for all, it was just for a select few, and I can't go along with that. What God demanded of humanity under the covenant of works he gave us in Jesus Christ. So let's just move quickly through this. The redemptive history reflects the unfolding of God's plan of salvation throughout Scripture. And again, the reason why we're saying this is because that it's not that God said, oops, you know, they didn't respond the way I thought they would respond, so now I'm going to have to shift direction here. Here's the bottom line, and this is really what we're talking about, that Jesus being the fulfillment. The Bible is one book with one central character who appears in two testaments, the older promise and the new fulfillment. And who do you think that central character is?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ. And this is what we mean by being Christological. When you talk about being Christological, you're just talking about Christ being the center of all Scripture. As Oral Roberts preached one time, and I've heard Bishop go through this also, that, you know, he goes through every book of the Bible, and there is a revelation of Jesus in every single book of the Bible. And we've already established this. We must interpret the Old Testament in light of the New, and our eschatology must be Christ-centered.
Absolutely.
Our eschatology must be Christ-centered. Your interpretation of the Scripture ought to be Christ-centered or Christocentric. That is another word. Christocentric just simply means Christ-centered. How can you go wrong in exalting Jesus? How can you go wrong in saying Jesus is the essence of everything? You know? How can you go wrong in saying that it pleased God the Father that in Jesus should all the fullness of Godhead dwell in bodily form? And how can you go wrong in saying that we're complete in Him?
Hallelujah.
So here's the bottom line. The story of redemption is the story of Jesus Christ and His kingdom. The story of redemption is the story of Jesus Christ and His kingdom. Now, let me reemphasize again why we're establishing this is because we will find there should be no distinction between natural Israel and the church. In other words, God is not going to deal with natural Israel any different than He's dealt with anyone else. And the natural Israelites are going to be brought through the same door. It's going to be Jesus. Jesus is the only way. He's the only name. Okay? So that's the reason why we had to interpret the story of redemption. See, there's one story of redemption. God will not revert back to an animal sacrificial system of the blood of bulls and goats. He will not reinstitute natural temple worship. He will not revert back to the Levitical priesthood. Jesus is a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, which means that he is a priest after an endless life with no beginning and no ending. Okay? The promises of the Old Testament concern the coming one to whom Israel's prophets, priests, and kings all pointed. The promises of the Old Testament concern the coming one. Now, let me stop here to say, and we will see This is going to be in defining a term, what we call prophetic perspective. Don't worry about that now because we'll get to it. The prophetic perspective basically says that there can be more than one, and all covenantal theologists, theologians, do not necessarily believe this. They believe, you know, that there is just one interpretation. But let me remind you that there was a basic form, or we could say there was a trend, that the Israelites continuously went through. They went through cycles. It went something like this. They walked with God. They turned away from God. God provided restoration. You go through the whole Old Testament. You go through every prophet. And that was really the theme. Being blessed of God. Being under the rulership of God. Under good kings that love God. And then going into rebellion. As a result of that rebellion, they suffered great harm. Went into captivity. But the hope of every prophet was that God would again extend his mercy and would restore them. That's the theme throughout all the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. Living under the blessings, walking away or being alienated from God and walking under a curse, and then God providing restoration. So, every prophet, the major prophets, minor prophets, had a particular thing in mind, a message that was intended for the natural nation of Israel in a particular period of time, okay? And that was basically, again, you know, there's warnings, you know, if you know that God's going to judge you or whatever, but there was always this promise of restoration. And so there was, the prophets would speak about, you know, of Israel, speaking of that particular period of time and that particular people as being restored back to God. But the far-reaching prophecy may not have even been something they themselves understood. In other words, when they prophesied, they may not have even thought, well, we're talking about the Christ, or this is going to be fulfilled in the Christ. Because ultimately, all restoration is going to come through the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, the scripture tells us in Acts chapter 3, I believe, that speaks about that the heavens shall receive him until the times of restitution of all things that were spoken of by the prophets. And we know that restoration comes. And, of course, the scripture also says, you know, that we're to repent, or in other words, change our mind, so that when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Old Testament people recognized three special offices, and those offices were prophet, priest, and king. And what are we talking about? We're talking about Christ being the fulfillment of all prophecies and all law. The Old Testament recognized three special offices. You might want to make a note of that because that is a very significant point. Prophet, priest, and king. In fact, those are the three offices that required an anointing. The prophet was anointed, the priest was anointed, and the king. This coming Messiah or Redeemer was expected to be the culmination and fulfillment of all three of these. That's the intent. See, Israel's expectation was that there would be a Messiah who would come and be the ultimate prophet and the ultimate priest and the ultimate king. So let's find out if this truly came to pass. Mm-hmm. Moses prophesied that God would raise up a prophet like himself from among the brethren, and he said, "Hear ye him." Now, here's where your prophetic perspective comes in, because ultimately this had to be speaking of Jesus. See, Jesus is Joshua. He's talking about Joshua here. Did you know that Jesus and Joshua are really the same name?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeshua or, yeah.
Yeshua.
Yeshua. Yeah.
Sure.
So Moses prophesied that there would be a prophet raised up among the brethren. Now, the thing that makes Christianity distinct from all the other major religions is that Christians believe that Jesus is not just the prophet, but he's the Son of God.
Yeah.
Peter, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Mm-hmm. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. So, you know, the Jews, as I understand, and maybe that I'm, well, maybe modern day Jews or a lot of Jews would probably recognize that Jesus was a prophet. And they may even recognize he was a good teacher. The Islams recognize Jesus as being a prophet. The Mormons, they believe Jesus was a prophet. See, Jesus wasn't just a prophet, he was the prophet.
The prophet, yes.
And he was the Son of God. Mm-hmm. I think I may have shared this in one of my classes, and this is really interesting because on Facebook I've been connecting with students from 40, 45 years ago. And there was really a young lady that was one of the sharpest students I had. And she was Jewish. And I think we developed a good relationship, you know, and we were able to share some things. And I asked her one day, and I won't call her name here, I said, I'd just like to ask you a question. I said, you know, you being Jewish, how do you and your Jewish family and friends, how do you see Jesus, you know? What do you consider Jesus? How does he fit into the scheme of things? And it's basically what she said. Well, we believe he was a good teacher, and we believe that he was a prophet. But we don't believe he's the Son of God. We don't believe he's the Messiah. And my response was this. Now, let me get this straight. You say he was a prophet, and he was a good teacher, but how can you believe a prophet that told a lie?
Right.
And I said, he declared himself being the Son of God, so how could you accept him as being a prophet if that's false?
And the same could be said to Muslims, not just Jews. But
exactly, yeah.
Because they as well believed he was a good, solid prophet. Either he was a prophet and told the truth, or he wasn't.
Exactly. And so he declared himself to be the Son of God, right?
What was her answer?
What's that?
What was her answer?
Well, that's been 45 years ago. Let me think about it, see if I can remember. I think her response was something like you know.
Not an answer.
Never thought about that.
Yeah.
Okay, the coming Redeemer is also the consummate high priest. Now keep in mind, the expectation of the Jews was what? Prophet, priest, king. Hebrews 4:14 says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Now here's what's really interesting about the Lord Jesus Christ. He was the sacrificial lamb, but he was also the priest.
Mm-hmm.
Which meant that he as a priest took his own blood
offer for sin.
And see, the blood was taken into the Holy of Holies, right? And was
yes.
applied to the seat of mercy above the covenant.
Seat, right?
Above the Ark of the Covenant. So Jesus literally, or spiritually speaking, which is really literally, all the others type and shadows. You know what was done in the Old Testament? Just types and shadows of the reality that was to come. And the reality is that Jesus took his own blood and went and applied it to the mercy seat. And I believe it's E.W. Kenyon who says something like this, that, and he pictures this and paints a picture and says, you know, that Jesus basically took his own blood and entered into the throne room of heaven and said to God the Father, here it is, here's my blood, for the redemption of all mankind. The sacrificial lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. So Jesus was definitely the high priest. Now what's interesting is that Jesus was not only the lamb, he was not only the high priest, but he was the temple. So why? See, he said, destroy this temple, in 3 days I'll raise it up. And they said, hey, he's bringing an accusation against this holy shrine that we call the temple. But he's speaking about his own body. See? Now think about this. Jesus was the lamb. He was a sacrifice. He was the priest. And he was the temple. So any implementation, again, of any earthly sacrifices, of any earthly priesthood order, or a literal temple, would just be reverting back to the types and the shadows
right.
that were fulfilled in reality in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Absolutely.
So again, that's the reason why.
After the order of Melchizedek.
And I think that may be my next script. No, yeah. You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. And this is in Psalm 110:4. And see, again, we have to understand again that the New Testament interprets the Old Testament. You remember who Melchizedek was?
Yes, he was the priest that
he was a priest and a king.
And the king that Abraham gave tithes to.
Melchizedek was the king of Salem.
Yep.
And Abraham was returning back from battle. He met Melchizedek. And gave him tithe. He paid tithes to Melchizedek, which we have no record of Melchizedek's beginning or his ending, which we could call that a Christophany or a theophany.
Ooh. You don't have to remember those words, right?
No, you got to spell it.
Christophany just simply means an appearance of Christ. In other words, a Christophany would be something that would took place in the Old Testament that could be interpreted as being the manifestation of Christ himself.
Mm-hmm.
For example, when the, was it Joshua said, "Who art thou?" And he said, "I am the captain of the host of the Lord."
Mm-hmm.
Or the fourth man in the fire.
Likened
to the Son. Did you say it, Son of Man or Son of God?
Son of God, I guess.
Son of God, I believe. So that was an appearance that was interpreted as being Christ himself.
Yep.
Okay, so that's what we call a Christophany. A theophany just simply means an appearance of God. Keith shaking his head. Christophany, C-H-R-I-S-T O-P-H-A-N-Y. The Christophany.